Good morning, students. How are you all? I hope so you all are doing well. So this is the revision session 4 from the subject Economics, Chapter 2, Sectors of the Indian Economy, Class 10. So in our previous lecture, we have started over with this chapter's revision and we have covered few of the topics. Now in this particular session, we are going to cover the rest of the topics from this particular chapter. So let's get started. So the topics that we are going to cover in this particular lecture are how to create employment. So first of all, we are going to discuss about this topic, how you can create employment in different sectors or in different areas in our country. So then we are going to jump into MGNREGA 2005, which is Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005, which you can also say at National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005 also. Then we'll talk about division of sectors as organized and unorganized sectors. Then we are going to discuss how to protect workers in the unorganized sector. So how you can protect the workers who are working under this unorganized sector. Then we'll discuss about the sectors in terms of their ownership between public and private sectors. And then I am going to assign you a homework for this particular lecture. And if you have doubts, you can come online in the online class session and tell me your doubts if there is any in this particular lecture. So I'm just going to start with the first topic now, how to create employment. So first of all, how you can create employment in different areas. So a way by which we can tackle this problem is to identify, promote and locate industries and a large number of people may be employed. So basically, first of all, how we can tackle with this problem is we should identify in which particular areas there is the employment sector is being insufficient. So basically, there are a large number of unemployed people around there. So we have to identify in terms of areas. So in particularly in कौन से particular areas में कहाँ पे number of unemployed members ज़्यादा हैं और कहाँ पे कम हैं. So we'll identify according to that कि problem कहाँ पे ज़्यादा और कहाँ पे कम है. So हम उसी according tackle कर सकें. Then प्रमोट एंड लोकेट इंडस्ट्री. सो उसी के अकॉर्डिंग हम वहाँ पे इंडस्ट्री सेटअप करें, वहाँ पे हम उस सेक्टर को इतना प्रमोट कर सके ताकि वहाँ पे हम एम्प्लॉयमेंट जनरेट करें. सो दैट्स वन द अनदर थिंग, हाउ कैन वी टैकल द प्रॉब्लम. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, वी हैव टू आइडेंटिफाई इन विच पर्टिकुलर एरियाज देर इज इन डेफिशिएंसी ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट. देन वी आर गोइंग टू प्रमोट एंड लोकेट इंडस्ट्री इन दैट पर्टिकुलर एरिया सो दैट we can generate more employment in those particular areas and a large number of people may be employed in such kind of areas. That's how you can tackle this problem. That is just one of the way and it is quite famous also in India. So basically they see, identify, promote and locate these industries to such an area where there is inefficiency of employment and a large number of people may be employed according to that. Then a study conducted by the Planning Commission estimates that nearly 20 lakh jobs can be created in the education sector alone. So basically a study has been conducted by the Planning Commission and he has particularly estimated that nearly 20 lakh jobs can be created in the education sector alone. So there is not only teachers that are working for you, there are so many other people who are working for you. So basically they are administrative department, then there is IT department, then there are many other sweepers who are working for you, other gardener, gatekeeper and so bookshopper. There are so many people out there who work under this education sector and make it better for you. So there is not only teacher, principal and the managing staff, there are a lot more people. And the Planning Commission has estimated that nearly 20 lakh jobs can be created in the education sector alone. So every state or region has the potential for increasing the income and employment for people in that area. So if you see that ki hum ye baat bhi karte hain ki rural areas mein employment jaldi se hum create nahi kar sakte, they have to deal with this farming activities only, but it is not like that. Every state or region has the potential for increasing the income and employment for people in that area. It has the potential, but we are not able to because we don't know our own capacities or our own value that yes, I can do this or I don't, I can't do that. So there's a lack of confidence within themselves and they settle for always less, but they can achieve more. So that's what I'm telling you every time, that don't settle for less. You can achieve more and more in life, so never settle for less. So that's what the thing is, कि कुछ ना कुछ तो मिल ही जाएगा उनको. तो they are thinking always कि हमें कुछ बस अपनी नीड पूरी करने के लिए चाहिए, but they are not, they never think big. So if you want to achieve big, you have to think big as well. So that's how it works. So the same study by the Planning Commission says that if tourism as a sector is improved, every year we can give additional employment to more than 5 lakh people. So the same study about this Planning Commission has says that if tourism as a sector is improved, so tourism is quite famous nowadays. So in my college also there was a course for tourism, and now tourism also can be a part of many of you if you are educated or not educated. If you aap us jagah ki kone kone se waqif hai, you can be a tourist guide or you can work under that particular area as a tourist person. So every year we can give additional employment to more than 5 lakh people in our own country if we promote such kind of sector in India. Then we must realize that some of the suggestions discussed above would take a long time off to implement, but if we are just discussing about it, but to implement such actions it takes a lot of time and struggle, and it is not easy to implement such actions very easily. So there are certain factors that depict these particular things. So recognizing this, the central government India made a law implementing the right to work. So basically, to recognize this thing, the government has taken certain actions so that the people should not भूख से ना मरे, या तो दे शुड बी वर्किंग समवेयर और दी अदर, उनको कुछ काम तो मिले तो दैट दे आर एम्प्लॉयड. सो फॉर दैट द गवर्नमेंट हैव टेकन सर्टेन एक्शन इन राइट टू वर्क. सो दे हैव स्टार्टेड विद महात्मा गांधी नेशनल रूरल एम्प्लॉयमेंट गारंटी एक्ट इन 2005, एंड अंडर दिस पर्टिकुलर एक्ट ऑल दोज हु आर एबल टू एंड आर इन नीड ऑफ वर्क आर गारंटेड 100 डेज ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट इन अ ईयर बाय द गवर्नमेंट. So under this particular act, all those who all the workers who are there around, they the government is giving them guarantee of 100 days of employment in a year, so that they do some or the other work. So the government is assigning them some of the work so that they can earn at least apna khud ka pet palne ke liye kuch paise kama sake, so that they are getting all the workers who are actually associated with this particular scheme, they are getting 100 days of guaranteed work. Now if the government fails in its duty to provide employment, it will give unemployment allowance to the people. So if the government fails its duty to provide them the employment, so they are giving us some of the other allowance or some of the other amount so that to such people, so that for book money se na mare, they are giving them some amount so that they can survive in this particular world. So they are giving them allowance if they are still unemployed and the government fails in its duty to provide them employment. So if we talk about NREGA, basically it is known as Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005. So it is started by the central government. So we have just discussed why it has been started. So in to think about right to work for the in the employment sector, it has been started by the central government, and under this particular act, all those who are unable to and are in need of work are guaranteed 100 days of employment in a year by the government. And if the government fails in its duty to provide employment, it will give unemployment allowance to the people. And the type of work that would be in future help to increase the production from land will be given preference under this act. So basically, this type of work is taken into consideration if in future it helps into increase the production from land, and it will give it will be given preference under such actions. So agar isse unka unko profit mil raha hai, so they are going to ye 100 days ko bhi wo increase kar sakte hain for such kind of employees if they are getting the profits out of it. So basically this type of work is could be good and could be bad, but it it doesn't have any bad effect for the particularly employees, because if they are working or they are employed or unemployed, they are still getting some of the other amount for their livelihood. Then division of sectors as organized and unorganized sectors. So now we are coming to the another topic, which is the division of sectors in organized and unorganized sector. So what are these particularly? So the organized sector covers those enterprises or places of work where the terms of employment are regular and therefore people have assured work. So basically in organized sector, all your family members also, many of them will be in the service sector who are working for someone and they are doing jobs, are employees in a particular company. So basically what they are in the organized sector, because they are covering all the enterprises and places of work where there is terms of employment are there, and they are on a regular employment. They are not like on wages pe wo kaam nahi karte, they are the regular employees and therefore people have assured work. So they have the guarantee of work that the amount of work they are doing, they will get certain amount from it. So now in organized sector is the benefit ye hota hai ki first of all they have the guarantee of work, then they have fixed hours, then certainly they have assured work, then the salary they are getting in return is also fixed. So in organized sector everything is under this term of employment, they have fixed certain things, and it is called organized because it has some formal processes and procedures. So in an organized sector there are certain formal terms and conditions in which the employee is doing all the work, and in turn he is getting some amount that is fixed for him, and he is proceeding with certain procedures that have been assigned to him. But in the unorganized sector is characterized by small and chartered units which are largely outside the control of the government. But the reverse is in the unorganized sector. जो ऑर्गेनाइज्ड सेक्टर में उसी का रिवर्स अनऑर्गेनाइज्ड सेक्टर में, बिकॉज दे आर नॉट गेटिंग एनी टर्म्स ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट इन दिस, दे आर जस्ट वर्किंग ऑन सम वेजेस बेसिस. मतलब स्मॉल और शार्टर यूनिट्स में दे आर वर्किंग फॉर पर्टिकुलर पीपल, एंड दे दिस पर्टिकुलर थिंग इज आउट ऑफ द कंट्रोल ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट बिकॉज दे आर जस्ट वर्किंग फॉर देयर लाइवलीहुड. तो उनको कुछ भी काम मिलता है दे आर डूइंग इट, because they are mostly coming under the unorganized sectors and unemployment sectors. So they just want some or the other kind of work to earn something for their livelihood. Now the jobs here are low paid and often not regular. So basically they are doing a lot of work, and for a lot of from 15 to 16 hours they take to do that particular work, but still they are low paid and they are not even regular. Employment is not secure in these particular unorganized sectors, and this sector includes a large number of people who are employed on their own doing small jobs such as selling on the streets and doing repair work etc. So basically in this particular sector there are large number of people who are employed. Basically you see the on the street there are number of people who are selling fruits, vegetables, and their repairing work are there for like cars and all that stuff. So basically there are a lot of people around us who are doing this particular work just for their livelihood. Then like in brief, if you want, we have to discuss this. So in organized sector, the sectors which carry out all activity through a system and follow the law of the land is called organized sector. Moreover, labor rights are given due to respect and wages are as per the norms of the country. Basically the labor rights, they have been given, they have been given respect, due respect for their wages. So they are all the amount they are going to work, the same amount they are going to get if it is assigned to them. So it is not been changing, they are not much of low paid, and then it is according to the norm of the country and those of the industry. And labor working organized sector get the benefit of social security, and it is by framed by the government, then certain benefits also they are getting which an unorganized, in unorganized sector they are not getting, like provident funds, leave entitlement, medical benefits, insurance are provided to workers in the organized sectors. And these security provisions are necessary to provide source of sustenance in case of disability or death of the main breadwinner of the family. So basically, who is the main one who is earning in the family? So if any disability or death occurs in that particular thing, so the other member who is the main one in the family, they are given assurance of work to them, and otherwise the dependents will face a bleak future. So basically all the benefits they are getting the provident fund, leave entitlement is also given to them, medical benefit, assurance, each and everything is given to these particular who are working in organized sector. But it's the reverse in the case of unorganized sector. Why? We will see this. So in the unorganized sector, the sector which await most of the laws and don't follow the system come under unorganized sector. Small shopkeepers, some small scale manufacturing units keep all their attention on profit making and ignore their workers' basic rights. So the sector which await most of the laws and they don't follow certain system in the unorganized sector. So they are not following any rules and regulations, any terms and conditions in unorganized sector. They are certainly small shopkeepers are there, as I just told you, on the working, they are working on streets, selling fruits and vegetables, or they must be employed in any of the repairing shops and all that stuff. So they, some are small scale manufacturing units, keep all their attention on profit making and ignore their workers' basic rights. So many in the, if you see in the manufacturing companies, the workers who work on some daily wages basis, so they just want to opt the maximum benefit they can get from their workers. They just want, their whole attention is on the profit, on nothing else. They just want to focus on the profit making thing and they ignore their workers' basic rights here. Now the workers don't get adequate salary and other benefits like leave, health benefits and insurance are beyond the imagination of people working in the unorganized sector. So it is the reverse in the unorganized sector. So there they are getting all the benefits, but here the workers are not getting any adequate salary and other benefits like leave, health benefits or insurance are beyond the imagination of people who are working in this particular sector. For example, people in domestic helpers or workers at local grocery shops. So basically all the people who are working as a domestic helper in the shops or in the grocery shops. So basically they don't have the right to leave at any time, and if they are they don't even have the assurance of that particular job. If the owner is not happy, they can just throw him away at any point of time from that particular place. So how we can protect the workers in these unorganized sectors? So how we can protect them? So they, basically there are certain laws that have been made for them, and in the organized sectors, the job offer jobs that they are getting are very sought after. So basically in the organized sector, they are quite sorted because they have the job offer letter, they have the contract with them. So there are legal things that happen in the organized sector, but the same is not there in the unorganized sector. It is also common to find many organized sectors enterprises in the unorganized sector. So basically you can commonly find in the organized sector also there are many people who are workers are there who are belonging to an unorganized sector, but still they are a part of it. Since in 1990s, it is also common to see a large number of workers losing their jobs in the organized sector. So basically if we see that our organized sector is also not we can say is certain, or they basically a lot of, if there is a recession of time, so many people can lose their job. Like currently we are in a situation of recession, we are in, most of the people are getting unemployed and they are not their job security is not at all there because the company doesn't have that much of fund so that they can pay them off. So they are just taking them off from their companies and they are now in the unorganized sector. So what is it that many times it has occurred? So it was happening in 1990 also. Now the same, if it is, this book has been written again, so the new chapter will came in 2020. There was a recession time with COVID-19 and there was a major recession session came and a large number of free workers have lost their jobs in the organized sector. So it has actually happened and we are just living in that reality. So in the rural areas, the unorganized sector mostly comprises of landless agriculture laborers, small and marginal farmers, sharecroppers and artisans. So in the rural areas, all the workers who are working in under this unorganized sector mostly comprises of landless agriculture laborers are there, small and marginal farmers are there, sharecroppers are there, artisans are there. So they are a part of this unorganized sector. But now if we see that there's a reverse role that happened. Now in the unorganized sector, if we talk about the current status, they still are getting some of the other amount because vegetables nahi to koi nahi chhodega, fruits nahi to koi nahi chhodega, because that is more the common thing they are taking, or all the agriculture activities are still going on, they are still earning some of the other thing, or the farmers are getting share crops, artisans, some of the other, they because they are working on their own, they are living on their own, so kuch to hai unke paas. But in the organized sector, if they lost their job, what they are going to do, how they are going to earn money, if they are going to, because there is not any other job opportunity they are going to have. So the cases are going to reverse. Obviously there is phir bhi jo disadvantages hai wo unorganized sectors ke paas zyada hai, but still ab organized sectors ke paas bhi advantages kuch nahi rahe hain mostly. So if they are working, you have a job, so it's a blessing. Like nearly 80% of rural households in India are in small and marginal farmer category. Mostly 80% of the rural workers are in the household, are there basically. They are the small and marginal farmer category. Jo bhi rural areas mein employees hain, they are working as a smaller marginal farmer in that particular category. And in the urban area and in unorganized sectors, they comprises mainly of workers in the small scale industry, casual workers in the construction, trade and transport, etc., and those who work as street vendors, hand load workers, garment makers, rag pickers, etc. So mostly in the urban areas, jo unorganized sectors mein mostly what are the work they do, so basically they are working under small scale industries, casual workers in the construction, trade and transport, etc., and those who work as street vendors, head load workers, garment makers, rag pickers, etc. So the thing that you can differentiate in rural areas and in urban areas is this. Now the sectors in terms of their ownership in public and private sector. So in the public sector, the government owns most of the assets and provide all the services. So what's the difference between the public and private sector? So in public sectors, all the major assets they have, all the like schools, hospitals, government hospitals, it is owned by the government and all the services are being provided by the government only. So in the public sector, the government is the one who owns most of the assets and provide all the services to the people. But in the private sector, the ownership of assets and delivery of services in the hands of private individuals or companies. The reverse in the case of the private sector. So the ownership of all the assets and the delivery of the services in the hand of the private individual. So if someone having their own businesses or their own companies or whatever, so the whoever is working there or whatever they are manufacturing, it is their own. So the ownership of all the assets and all the delivery of services is in the hands of private individuals or the companies. And the activities in the private sector are guided by the motive to earn profit. So the like all the activities that happen in the private sector, the main thing is there in their mind to earn as much profit out of it as they can. So there is nothing, so they are giving public service to the people and they are getting just enough amount or just as a remuneration. No, they are just working all these activities they are taking, just keeping in mind to motivate to earn profits out of it and the maximum. So the purpose of the public sector is not just to earn profits, but to the government raises money through taxes and other ways to meet expenses on the services rendered by it. So basically all the flyovers you see, the toll plazas you see, the roads that are building up and public schools, hospitals, in sabka jo kharcha hota hai, ye sara hamare taxes se nikalta hai. So the purpose of the public sector is not just to earn profit. There is a lot of other things. So the government raises money through taxes and other ways to meet the expenses of all these activities they are, all the services they are providing to the public sector. So community parks jo bhi hote hain by them, that is given by the government. Now the stadiums, flyovers are building, roads are building, and all these things are there, all these services are there. Inke liye bhi kuch money chahiye hota, so they are raising this money through some taxes that are allotted to things. So uske through they meet these expenses on the services rendered by it. Now there are several things that are needed by the society as a whole, but which the private sector will not provide at a reasonable cost. There are a lot of several things that is needed by the society as a whole, but which the private sector will not be will not provide at a reasonable cost. Obviously अगर आपको अच्छी सर्विसेज चाहिए, सब कुछ बेटर वे में चाहिए, सो ऑब्वियसली द प्राइवेट सेक्टर इज नॉट गोइंग टू प्रोवाइड यू एट अ वेरी रीजनेबल रेट दैट द गवर्नमेंट इज प्रोवाइडिंग. दे आर गोइंग टू चार्ज एज मच एज दे कैन टू अर्न द मैक्सिमम प्रॉफिट आउट ऑफ इट. सो कलेक्टिंग द मनी फ्रॉम थाउजेंड्स ऑफ पीपल हु यूज दी फैसिलिटीज इज नॉट ईजी. सो बेसिकली the collecting of this money also from thousands of people and using their facilities is not easy. Even if they provide these things, they would charge a high rate of theirs. So if they are providing you services, if they are providing you all the better benefits, so they are going to charge a high rate from these kind of services, and they are going to earn the maximum profit as they can. Thus the government have to undertake such heavy spending and ensure that these services are available for everyone. So that's why government also have initiated to undertake such heavy spendings and ensure that these facilities are given to each and every person out there and at a nominal price, and it should be available to everyone at a reasonable price so that each and everyone can buy it. But the same is different with the private sector. So if they are selling something and giving it in a better way, they are going to charge as high as possible. But in the government sector, if they are, they want to provide each and everything, they are giving them, but not at that particular facility that they are giving, but they are available for everyone at a reasonable price. So it depends on how much amount you have, how much you can spend, you want which kind of services. So it all depends on that. Then there are some of the activities which the government has to support. So basically in the private sector, all the activities are not assured that ki they sari services aap high rate pe charge karoge. They need certain government license also to plan out these services, and they have to give them certain amount of taxes also out of it. So there are some of these activities which the government has to support, so to have a fruitful what we can say, fruitful journey or from these particular things, we can say that. So this is whole as a chapter. We have done the revision. Still you have queries from any of the topics, just let me know in the doubt session now or in the online class. So just rejoin there. And sorry, there are one more points also. So the private sector may not continue their production or business unless government ensure it. So the private sector may not continue their production or business unless government ensures it. Just I have just told you that in the private sector also, they may not continue their production if the government is not ensuring them, is not giving them the proper license. So for that particular thing, they are costing something, so the government has to bear a part of the cost. So for the licensing and for the profit sharing, all the government is taking some portion out of it. then there are a large number of activities where there is the primary responsibility of the government, and the government must spend on these, like providing health and education facilities for all is one example. So basically the medical facilities and the education facilities is the must thing. So the government is providing them to maximum people as possible at a very reasonable rate. So basically some are free also, and some are taking only a little amount of it, the government who are taking. So the government also needs to pay attention to aspects of human development. So the government is also paying certain attention on the aspects of human development as well, because it is also the duty of the government to take care of the poorest and most ignored regions of the country through increased spending in such areas. So basically the government is taking certain actions because the maximum profit is being taken in the urban areas or in the urban sections where there is not much needed. So they want that they are taking care of all the poorest and the most ignored regions of the country as well, so that there should be a balance maintained in the entire country and not giving certain benefits to only some part of the area and not giving to the other. So it is the duty of the government to take care of each and every part of the area and give them the equal facilities. So the homework for this lecture is read the chapter again and write notes. So you have to write notes on your own on the following topics. You have to difference between organized and unorganized sectors. You have to tell that. You have to tell the difference between the organized and the unorganized sector here. Now, how you can create employment in urban areas? You have to tell how you can create employment in urban areas. Then difference between private and public sectors. And NREG 2005, you have to make notes in these particular topics. So that's it. If you have doubts, come in the online class session. We are meeting it again with your doubts. If you have any, just let me know. And thank you so much for listening to this lecture. Just take care of yourself.